So let's not get tired of doing what is good at just the right time. We will reap a harvest of blessing if we don't give up. McLean Church, what's going on? My name is Chris Norris. I'm the online site pastor here. And man, are you tired of doing good? Because I'm not, right? That's one of my favorite verses from Galatians 6, verse 9. And it just speaks to me because I was thinking about the seasons of life, right? And actually, more specifically, the seasons that are happening around us. As you can see, lots of sunlight coming in the room today. Hopefully, you're watching somewhere where there is sun shining in your living room, your car, wherever you are. The seasons are changing here in northwestern Pennsylvania. It does feel like maybe, just maybe, spring / summer is finally here. And I thought about the last 6, 8, 12 months of my life and perhaps yours, and how the seasons have changed drastically. No, not the weather, but perhaps the season of life you're in. Perhaps you've gone through a difficult situation, a difficult circumstance. You've lost a loved one, a friend, a relationship has been broken, a job has been lost. A lot has changed in our lives, in our realities over the last 2.5 years. And I just want you to be encouraged by that today, that God is still present in that waiting season. God is still present in that dark season. God is maybe partying with you in a great season that maybe you're in right now. But just know that God is in that season with you. God doesn't waver in his presence, right? No matter what the season looks like for you, hopefully sunny and warm, but God is there, and God sees us through each season of our life, no matter how difficult it can be. And I thought that that verse just reminds me, Galatians 6, 9, it says, so let's not get tired of what is doing, of doing good. At just the right time, we will reap a harvest of blessing if we don't give up. If we don't give up, God is with you. Don't give up today. Be encouraged as we move from one season to the next. Literally, maybe you're moving from a new season in your life, and be encouraged that God is present. Well, anyway, we're glad that you are here at McLean Church Online, and whether you're watching during one of our live interactive services on Sunday morning, or maybe you're watching during the week on YouTube, we're glad you're here. We want to make sure we understand and get to know who you are and where you're coming from, right? So make sure you visit mcleanchurch.org and learn more about us, or you can click right here on this page. There's a connection button at the top where you can click and fill out some information and let us know how you heard about our church, how maybe we can help you take a next step in your faith. If you're joining right now on Sunday morning, make sure you say hello in the chat space. We love to hear from you. We love to hear where you're watching from. We love to hear what you're maybe eating for breakfast or doing on a Sunday afternoon with your family. Church is all about spending time together and being in community, and that's what we like to do here at McLean Church Online. Well, I don't know about you guys, but I'm gonna pop in my earbuds because I am ready to worship today. I'm turning the volume up, and I am singing praise to my God today. So would you do the same here as we spend time worshiping together at McLean Church Online?
Hello, McLeaners, and welcome. Let us joyfully lift up our hearts together in worship to our God of glory.
Drive the dark clouds out away. Give her an eternity. depths of happy rest.
You are the one.
John 19 says, Jesus knew that his mission was now finished. And to fulfill scripture, he said, I am thirsty. A jar of sour wine was sitting there, so they soaked a sponge in it, put it on a hyssop branch, and held it up to his lips. When Jesus had tasted, he said, it is finished. Then he bowed his head and gave up his spirit.
Of cow.
But what a way to get our services started today. And thank you, worship team, for sharing your talents and for getting our hearts prepared to hear a word from God. But in the meantime, let's take this opportunity to give back our tithes and our offerings to God. You can simply do that, as you know, by visiting mclainchurch.org/give, or as always, we recommend downloading our McLain Church mobile app, where we make it very easy for you to give back to the mission of what God is doing in and through our church. Thank you for being a generous church.
Welcome, everyone, whether you're listening or watching to this online, listening on the radio, or attending one of our in-person services. We're really glad that you chose to be with us this week. My name is Rick Scaletta, and if you don't know me, I recently retired from the General McLain School District after serving 41 years as a teacher and administrator. Since retiring last July, I've been spending a good chunk of time here at McLain Church, doing some administrative duties. I facilitate the young adult ministry called Waymakers on Tuesday nights, work with high school youth on Wednesday nights, and occasionally sing on the worship team. I have found McLain Church to be an awesome place to be. The staff here is just incredible to work with. And if you are not presently serving in one of our ministries, I would just really encourage you to check it out and lead a very fulfilling life by being part of what we do here. Pastor Brian is off this week and he will be back next week, but he asked me to share a message with you for this week. So let's begin this like we begin many conversations. How about this great weather we've been having? Here in Northwest Pennsylvania, you know that we've had a great week of summer-like weather with clear blue skies and highs in the 70s and 80s. And I don't know about you, but for me, that means one thing. I'm out in the yard. I like gardening and I like dirt. Dirt stays where you put it. It doesn't talk back and it's not judgmental. So I do enjoy gardening. But for the sake of full disclosure, let me tell you that I grew up in a city on a very small lot where all we did was cut the grass. But my grandparents lived on the second floor. And my grandfather had an interesting profession. He was a huckster. He sold fruits and vegetables from door to door. He started his business on a horse and wagon, eventually then moved to a pickup truck, and then he bought a panel truck by the time I came along, which was basically like a little store on wheels. So when I was about 7 or 8, I was taught that vegetables come from a seed and that the seed gets planted in the ground. So I really wanted to grow something. So I took a watermelon seed and I put it in a patch of ground that was rock hard. And I watered it, but that poor seed had no chance in that ground. So about a week into it, after checking it every day, my family and I, my parents, my grandparents were sitting on the patio. And my grandfather said, "Did you check your watermelon today?" And I said, "No." So I ran over and there was a large, green, ripe watermelon. And for about 3 seconds, I was excited and then thought, wait a minute, something's not right here. I heard my family chuckling. And of course, my grandfather had taken a watermelon and just set it there. Well, I've learned a lot since then. I started gardening when I was an adult. And I haven't made that mistake since. But when I'm in the yard, I see many parallels between nature and our Christian faith. and I'd like to share three of those with you. Many years ago, my wife told me that her favorite flowers were zinnias and cosmos. So I purchased a pack of seeds for each, and there were about 20 seeds in each packet. And I planted them, and they grew. At the end of the season, when they died back, I harvested the seeds. I planted those seeds the next year. They grew. At the end of that year, I had more seeds to harvest. And so if you came onto my property now in August and early fall, you would see hundreds of zinnias and cosmos all over the yard. And it all came from 20 seeds. Now, that makes me think about Matthew 28, that we call the Great Commission. Matthew 28 reads as follows. Jesus came and told his disciples, "I have been given all authority in heaven and on earth. Therefore, go and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Teach these new disciples to obey all the commands I have given you. And be sure of this, I am with you always, even to the end of the age." I think the way flowers reproduce is a great reminder of this passage, because we as Christ followers have the obligation to spread the gospel, to spread Christ's love. And when we spread Christ's love, the people who are the recipients of it, then they spread Christ's love. And the people they spread it to, spread it. So that over time, just like the flowers in my yard, we have a host of Christ followers. Now, a second example I like to think about is pruning. Pruning is a process where you cut off dead growth of a vine, say, but you also cut back the living growth, which seems very counterproductive. Each year, there are many things in my yard that gets pruned, but I have a trellis in the front of my vegetable garden, and I grow trumpet vines on the trellis. And this year, I gave it a very hard pruning, as you can see from this picture. Now, when you finish pruning like that, you feel like, oh my gosh, I've killed it. Like you've destroyed it, because it looks pretty bad. But the thing is, it comes back even stronger, and it grows even fuller after the pruning. And this is an example that is also used in the Bible. In John 15, the second verse, "He cuts off every branch of mine that doesn't produce fruit, and he prunes the branches that do bear fruit, so they will produce even more." A perfect description of pruning, so that we produce even more. Now, the idea of pruning is also connected with the idea of discipline in the Bible. Discipline not in the sense of being punished for doing something wrong, but discipline refers to learning or training. Disciples are people, it's from the same word, they are people who follow a teacher. So when it comes to discipline, we can look at Hebrews 12th chapter, 11th verse. "No discipline is enjoyable while it is happening. It's painful. But afterward, there will be a peaceful harvest of right living for those who are trained in this way." So sometimes in life, we are pruned. I think the pandemic is a good example of it. Many people felt like they were cut back. We cut back on our activities. We cut back on everything. But for many people, it became a time of growth, a time to learn a new hobby, to learn how to cook, learn how to bake, a time to improve ourselves. Businesses reinvented themselves, churches reinvented themselves. So pruning, while it looks horrible at first, can be very, very beneficial. Now, no talk of gardening would be complete without referring to weeds. We all hate them. Even if you're not a gardener, if you have a yard, you know that weeds can be annoying. And the problem with weeds isn't just how they look, Matter of fact, some people just say, hey, they're green, I'll live with them. But they take nutrients from the soil and they take moisture from the soil that the plants you want to grow need. So the weeds become problematic. But I think about it too in terms of the weeds in our life. You know, weeds in our lives are those distractions that take us away from a right relationship with God. We face them every day. Maybe it's social media, spending too much time playing video games, too much time doing anything that might distract from time that you spend with God. So when you're looking at weeds and pulling them out, it's a good time to think about what in my life could I weed out. Now, the Bible was written throughout the time it was written. It was an agrarian culture, and so references to growing things and crops were abundant. Jesus used weeds for one of his parables. It's the parable of the weeds and the wheat from Matthew 13. Here's another story Jesus told. The kingdom of heaven is like a farmer who planted good seed in his field. But that night, as the workers slept, his enemy came and planted weeds among the wheat, then slipped away. When the crop began to grow and produce grain, the weeds also grew. The farmer's workers went to him and said, "Sir, the field where you planted that good seed is full of weeds. Where did they come from?" "An enemy has done this," the farmer exclaimed. "Should we pull out the weeds?" they asked. "No," he replied, "you'll uproot the wheat if you do. Let both grow together until the harvest. Then I will tell the harvesters to sort out the weeds, tie them into bundles, and burn them, and to put the wheat in the barn." So we see in this parable that Jesus is telling us we're going to have wicked people with us. We're going to have negative things, and he'll sort it out when he gets back. But the weeds that we can control in our life, there are some we can't. There are those people that may not live righteously or may not believe in God, but they're going to be with us, and we need to learn to deal with it, just like we need to deal with the weeds in our own life. Now, when we talk about seeing God in nature, theologians actually have some terms: general revelation and special revelation. Now, general revelation refers to God revealing himself to us through nature or natural means. Special revelation refers to God's revealing of himself in miraculous ways, primarily through scripture, maybe through people in our lives, maybe through a pastor. That's special revelation. Now, I'm going to talk about general revelation, and you've probably all experienced it at one time or another. Think of being somewhere where you are just overwhelmed by the beauty. Maybe the Grand Canyon or Niagara Falls, and just the vastness of it makes you realize that there has to be a divine creator, an intelligent creator behind this, because it's so beautiful and it's so just breathtaking. And I think we've all experienced that. And I think it's easy to experience God in those vast, beautiful creations. But I also want to remind you that it's there in smaller things. For example, let's take the yearly cycle of a deciduous tree. So all winter we have these trees with bare wood just sort of looking there, you know, nothing to look at. But then all of a sudden in the spring, little green starts to poke out. And then it gets bigger and bigger, and flowers come out on some trees. Where does it come from? Have you ever thought about that? Where does it all come from? It's so beautiful, and it's so amazing if you think about it. And then we get to the fall, and we know that the trees are going to lose their leaves, but we get this beautiful, radiant display of orange and red and yellow, and it's like God saying, "Hey, before they go, let me just show you my splendor one more time." And I think that we have to always look at these small things. We have to recognize God's handprint all over them and be aware of His glory in the small things of nature. Now, let's talk a little bit about basil. Basil is a wonderful plant. The smell is amazing. Think about the taste in a caprese salad, fresh, lush tomato, fresh mozzarella, some balsamic vinaigrette, a little olive oil, and basil. Just brings it alive. Have you ever seen a basil seed? It is tiny. It is a tiny, tiny round speck. If it was actually on the back of your hand, you probably wouldn't even notice it. That's how small it is. Yet this tiny seed turns into a plant that has several stems and many, many leaves that produce this amazingly robust flavor. To me, that's just amazing. It is a wonderful piece of evidence of God's work in this world. So next time you sit down to your spaghetti, think about the basil plant and God's amazing creation. Here's another thing that I think about and just blows my mind. There are hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of species of plants. And there are different species in different parts of the world. But even within those species, there are many varieties. Did you know that there are at least 15 varieties of kale? Now, I know for some people, one variety is enough. But to me, it just is amazing that you can have essentially the same plant with so many variations. Now, there is a scripture that speaks to this whole idea of general revelation. It comes from Romans. It's in the first chapter, 20th verse. For ever since the world was created, people have seen the earth and sky. Through everything God made, they can clearly see His invisible qualities, His eternal power and divine nature. So they have no excuse for not knowing God. One translation says, we are without excuse. And the whole idea there is, we just have to believe when we see God's creation. I had an opportunity once, I spent some time with a pastor from the Church of God, and he was talking to me about what he does when people say to them, well, I don't believe in God. He would ask them to make a commitment to do something. He would say, I'm not going to tell you what it is, but you just tell me you'll do it, and then we'll do it. And when people would commit, he would ask them to, he would pick them up at a very early hour in the morning before the sun came up. He would drive them to this spot he had on top of a mountain that overlooked a beautiful valley, and he would sit there with them until the sun came up and would say, how can you not believe in a divine creator when you see this? And that's really a great example of general revelation. Now, there's also a psalm that speaks to this idea of general revelation. It is Psalm 19, and it's going to be on your screen, and I'd like you to read it with me. The heavens proclaim the glory of God. The skies display His craftsmanship. Day after day, they continue to speak. Night after night, they make Him known. They speak without a sound or word. Their voice is never heard. Yet their message has gone throughout the earth and their words to all the world. God has made a home in the heavens for the sun. It bursts forth like a radiant bridegroom after his wedding. It rejoices like a great athlete eager to run the race. The sun rises at one end of the heavens and follows its course to the other end. Nothing can hide from its heat. Such beautiful words. And if you think about a starlit night, clear sky, looking up into the vast universe, it cries out. It speaks of God's glory. It says, look at the Creator. Look at what He has done. Let's not forget to take advantage of those opportunities. And finally today, I want to share with you one of my favorite garden scriptures. It comes from the sixth chapter of Galatians. Don't be misled. You cannot mock the justice of God. You will always harvest what you plant. Those who live only to satisfy their own sinful nature will harvest decay and death from that sinful nature. But those who live to please the Spirit will harvest everlasting life from the Spirit. So let's not get tired of doing what is good. At just the right time, we will reap a harvest of blessing if we don't give up. Therefore, whenever we have the opportunity, we should do good to everyone, especially to those in the family of faith. I love that passage, and I actually have that scripture citation over the entrance to my garden. And some translations say, we reap what we sow. We reap what we sow. There's actually a song from a Broadway musical called The Fantastics. And in the musical, there are two widowers. They are neighbors. One is raising a teenage son and one is raising a teenage daughter. And they often meet at the fence between their homes and have discussions. And one day they're lamenting the unpredictability of teenagers. And they sing a song called Plant a Radish. Plant a radish, get a radish, not a Brussels sprout. That's why we love vegetables. We know what they're about. And so God uses this fact of nature to say to us, it's the same in our lives. If we plant seeds of hate and prejudice and disagreement and ugliness, that's what happens in our life. But if we plant seeds of love and compassion and understanding, it creates a different kind of life. And I think that we all want to think about that, and the idea of reaping what we sow is very important to keep in mind. So what do we do with all this? Well, first I want to share some related things happening at the church. This past week, our high schoolers, who are part of what we call McLean Youth, made 15 self-wicking bucket gardens. These are 16-gallon tubs that are going to be self-watering, that will grow lettuce and some herbs in the middle. And our teens are going to deliver them to senior citizens in the community and keep in touch with them. And the seniors, there's a pipe where they're watered that you don't even have to bend over to water them. If you like to see them, they're on the north patio of our Edinburgh campus. But they'll be delivered in June to the seniors, and our students will keep in touch with the recipients of those gardens. The other thing we're doing is our Waymaker group, our young adult ministry, is going to put a scripture walk into the small group of trees to the north of the Edinburgh property. It's not owned by us, but we have permission to do that, and we're going to put a little path with scripture citations, and we'll let you know when that's done so you can take advantage of that. So in conclusion, some personal action points. Number one, take advantage of general revelation by getting outside and witnessing God's beauty. Put down the remote, put down the gaming paddles, put down the electronic devices, and get out and let God reveal himself to you in the beautiful creation that he has made. And a second thing you can do is actually combine general and specific revelation by reading scripture outside. Did you know that there's actually research that shows that we learn better outside? There's a field of education called outdoor education. There are outdoor classrooms, outdoor amphitheaters, and we know that we can learn better outside. So take your Bible outside, or I suppose you could use the app on your phone, and read some scripture and let God talk to you both through scripture and through the beautiful creation that he has made. Thank you for being with us this week, and we hope to see you next week at one of our locations.
Every trial, every circumstance, still your mercy covers me. Every battle, to understand. Still I lift my voice and sing.
Yeah, sing!
Today, tomorrow, and forever, I will live for you. Today, tomorrow, and forever, I will worship you. You have been faithful. You have been kind to me. You hold my future in your hands. So in the world shaking, the ground beneath my feet, you're the solid rock on which I stand.
Yeah, I stand.
Today, tomorrow,
what a wonderful time we got to spend together today here at McLean Church Online. It's always an honor to spend time with you, to celebrate your wins and to pray for your losses. That's what I'm here to do. That's what our team is here to do for you. So if you have any specific needs or prayer requests or questions, don't hesitate to reach out to me using my email at cnorris@mcleanchurch.org. I love connecting with you guys, not only virtually, but perhaps in person over a cup of coffee. I would love to hear about all the exciting things happening in your life and what God is doing in your life in particular. Also, there's a lot of stuff happening at McLean Church. We're entering into a fun season of spring and summer, so I want to encourage you to visit mcleanchurch.org. Lots of information on there. I don't want to spend time going over everything. I'll let you check that out for yourselves. And as always, stay connected with us so you know what's going on and how you can be involved and be a part of the church, right? The people, the community of McLean, by following all of our social media accounts at McLean Church. Until next time, I hope you guys have a fantastic day, a wonderful week, and remember that God is present with you each and every step of your day and each and every season of life. Have a good one. We'll see you back here next week at McLean Church Online.